morning, friends. Today we'll talk about operating system, basics of operating system. So this is what we have planned as an agenda for today's talk. One is, what is an operating system? That's what exactly we mean by operating system. This is what we are going to cover up. Then what are the various components of operating system and classification, which can say, okay, this is the way we can classify various operating system which are there. Now, once we say what is an operating system, it's basically a resource allocator and a manager, as I said. Then another aspect is ki it acts as an interface between programmers and the computer resources. Okay, what is a programmer wants to do? Maybe he will never go to up to the hard disk level or up to the processor level to execute his jobs. And the way he will be writing his codes and other things, he will not like okay, what sort of a memory has been allocated to his process, what sort of things has been allocated to him vis-a-vis I.O., when an I.O. has been allocated, he will not like to know it. What he will like to know is, okay, this is the resource which is available to him. The way he would like to use it, he should be able to use that. So that's what we say. There is some sort of interface required. Interface between programmer and the computer resources. Because let's say, if I look at my computer resource may be slower, whereas my memory may be very fast. How exactly that sort of a transfer can take place? Is it programmer has to control that particular thing, or my operating system will be doing this particular aspect for me? Then another is, it acts as an interface between the user and the computer hardware. Now let's say initially I was telling you, we have got hardware with me. My hardware can be my keyboard, my mouse, my printer, my memory, all sort of things are nothing but your hardware there. Now each of them has got its own characteristics of working. Let's see, as far as my main memory is concerned, it may be giving a very faster access. Whereas same way if I look at my secondary memory, it may be giving me very slow access. Then same way in case I have got a printer, it may be not be able to take the data the same speed as my memory would be giving the information there. So like there are so many things which has to be taken care. Once we say, okay, we have to interface this particular aspect with the program there. So this is, they act as an interface between user and the computer hardware. So this is what we call as the OS architecture. Now as far as user is concerned, he is at this particular point only. As far as the user is concerned, he is not bothered what exactly is happening at this particular stage there. But what his aim is, let's say as a user, what I would like to do? I would like to, if I am an application user, I am an application developer, maybe I will be writing my routines through which I will be making use of the resources. Or I may be just a user. Let's say you think about a clerk who is sitting on a monitor. What he is doing, he is just using some of the application which has been developed by somebody else. Right? Now, how exactly he can use it? Or how can somebody else can use it? This is what we say, okay, this is application. Maybe some sort of application which may be executing at that particular point only. Then, my application may be there in a particular environment. Of course, as a user, if I'm just an operator for that particular application, I'm not concerned. What is available to me is just an application which I have got an executable for that particular application. I'm using it. I'm very comfortable in giving my commands. Now, it is the operating system who has to interpret your commands, what sort of commands you're giving, and what sort of answers it has to take it from the computer hardware there. That is one sort of a uses which I expect for the computers which one has to perform. Then another is, let's say I'm the developer. As a developer, I may be requiring some sort of languages. Maybe I require C++ or I require some sort of editor. What we mean by editor is, let's say I have to edit my program. I have to write my program. What I require is some sort of a resource through which I should be able to edit my programs there. So basically, it is an editor or C++ which will be doing this particular aspect for me. But that is, as a developer, I will be using this particular layer, loader or utilities. What's the utilities? Maybe some sort of utilities which are helping me in executing my programs. As I said, loaders, maybe linkers are there, dynamic linking is there. So all sort of things are there, which has to be coordinated at this particular place over here. So this is another interface which we have got. Obviously, it is at the user's level only. Now, how the user is interacting with the system is, he is to interact in this particular fashion only. Either he will be using some applications or he will be developing some sort of applications there. These are the major uses which are there in case of a computers. Now, and this has to be performed on your hardware there. Okay, whatever has to be done, that has to be done on your hardware. Okay, basically, it's a hardware. Who will be doing this thing for me? But my C++ program may not be straightaway understandable by the hardware there. So whatever are the commands which I'm giving, somebody has to interpret those sort of a commands, and this is what my operating system is doing this particular aspect for me. What is doing? Whatever I'm trying to do, it is just helping me in doing it. Another aspect of operating system is there, okay, it doesn't do anything of its own. As we usually say, it's just like a government. Okay, a government doesn't do anything of its own. Ideal government, it doesn't do anything of its own. But it makes people to do certain things. Let's say it provides you environment, it provides you facilities through which you can do this particular aspect there. So this is what we call as a operating system. So this is the component which is intermediate between computer, a hardware, as well as the users there. Now, maybe how exactly this thing is being done? It is quite possible. Okay, there may be something required. It's not a one type of a operating system which will be doing it for all the things for me. Maybe I require some sort of a system calls. I require some sort of a system routines to perform this sort of things over there. So basically, it's an operating system which provides me some sort of interface through which I can perform all this particular task which has to be done by this particular hardware there. If I go back, initially I said it's a resource allocator and manager, or it is an interface between computer hardware and the users. I think this is what we call as an interface. Okay, some sort of an interface which is defined. Okay, this is the way I will be working. Now, another thing I said was, okay, it is basically a resource allocator and a manager. Now, what sort of resources are there? Maybe whatever are the resources at your hardware stage. Now, once we say it's a hardware, your all type of hardware, whether it's a peripherals, whether it's a resources which are memory and other things which are available to the computer. So, all these are being managed by this particular operating system. It is quite possible. Okay, I got certain resources. Let's say I got a CPU with me. I got a CPU. Now, this CPU is to be used by only one application. Who will assure it? Now, ideally speaking, let's say I got only one computer. There is only one person who is working on that particular system. My life is very easy because all the resources are available to that particular process only, or that particular programmer only. But in case I have got a number of applications running, who decides to whom this particular resource is to be given and to this particular person this resource is not to be given? This is again decided by this particular operating system only. He decides, okay, this resource I will be allocating to him and this resource I will not be allocating to him. Because this is very important. Then, as I said, it's an interface between programmer and computer resource. That again, we said. So, this is the broader architecture as far as your operating system is concerned. Now, once we say this is the operating system which we have got, it's not, because if I look at operating system, maybe what are its resources are there, maybe I have got a network with me. I have got a number of a computer which are attached to the computer. That is another type of resource. It can be single user resources which can be there. It can be distributed resources which can be there. How exactly my operating system will be doing it? Because that comes as a major question there. How exactly my operating system will be doing all these things for me? Is it there is only one module which will be doing all these jobs for me? Or what I do is, okay, I define, okay, these are some of the tasks which are there for as far as my computer is concerned, as far as my user is concerned, and this is, has to be done by this particular individual, this particular system. So this is how, what sort of a division we have got. Okay, this is what we call as a major component of your operating system. Okay, basically what we have to do is, we have to execute your program. Now, once we say we have to execute our program, it's the processor who is to execute your processes. So, somehow, in case there is only single process there, there is no management which is required. But the moment there is a number of more than one process which is there in the system, I have to have some sort of process management over there. That is, processor has to manage okay, which process has to be given this processor and which once process is over, then it has to be taken back from that particular process there. So this is what we call as the process management. Now then another is the moment any process is to execute, I require some sort of a memory there. Because every process has to store some of its variables, some of its files in the memory there. Now what we have to have is okay, some sort of a system through which I can manage this sort of a memory there. What do we mean by memory management? Okay, let's say there are six, in case there is only one process, what will I do? I will be allocating this whole memory to only one process. But let's say the moment the number of processes increases, let's say then what I have to do? I have to decide to which process I should allocating the memory, to which process I will not be allocating the memory there. That is again the decision which then operating system has to take. That is what we call as a memory management. Then another thing he has to see, there is no conflict between two processes. Let's say there is a process A, he is executing, and there is a one process B which is executing. Let's say he start accessing the memory of the process B. What will happen? Again, there will be chaos. Okay, there will be conflict between the memory there, okay, in case somebody else is trying to access somebody else's memory. So this is another part which is there. Now, once we say memory management, we usually talk about this primary memory only, but secondary memory, whatever hard disk and other things are there, again, same aspect are there, whether it is allocation of the hard disk or allocation of the space on the hard disk or deallocation of the space on the hard disk there. But broadly, memory management can be classified into two. One is primary memory management. Another is a secondary storage management. How exactly I can manage the secondary storage there? Maybe in some of the text, you will find this in the two components. One is the memory management. Another is the hard disk management. Because what in some of the literature, they do say okay, it's a memory management. Basically, primary memory and the secondary memory management which is there. Then another is a file management. The moment I have to work on a system, what I have to do is, I have to open a file. That is a primary, there is a bare minimal which you have to do. You have to open a file, and in that particular file, you will be making all sort of a processing there. Maybe you will be deleting it, you will be writing something into this. So this is what we call as a file management. The next type of management which we have to perform is, that is the IO management. Another very important component of the operating system. Let's say once we say IO is nothing but input outputs. Maybe I have got a printer, I have got a scanner, I have got a monitor there, or a different type of IO devices are there. Now each of the device has got its own characteristics. By characteristics we mean the way it will be working, the way it will be taking the data from the system to the device there. Maybe a device is faster, other device is slower. So all these sort of aspect, whether some device driver should be there, or some other aspect which are required. That is what is taken care at the level of this IO management. Okay. IO management takes care of all your aspect of various types of devices which are there, how to configure the devices. Maybe some, once I say you have to configure the device, what do we mean by that? Whatever is the driver which is required for this particular device has to be loaded into the memory there. Maybe it is available on your hard disk, but you have to load it into the memory. So this is what we call as the IO management. Then another aspect is your protection system. Maybe I have got a single system with single user system with me. I don't require any protection for that, because I, as a single user, will be you making use of that particular system. You imagine you allow your system to be used by 3 or 4 persons. So what will you do? Maybe you would like to give him some sort of a login, some sort of passwords through which he can protect himself. That is, I would not like my files to be seen by somebody else. Or some of the files which are available to me only shouldn't be altered by somebody else. Maybe in case I am the only user for this particular system, I may not require any sort of a protection mechanism for that. Maybe what I do is simple protection. What I do is I lock up my room and go away. That's a great protection which I can provide to my system. I don't link it with the internet. I don't link it with anything else. That is the ideal protection which I can provide to my system. But world is not like this, because you have to work in a network environment. You have to work in a distributed environment. So what we have to have is some sort of a mechanism through which I can protect my files from the others there. So maybe logins are there through which you can protect, or some sort of a protection bits are there for each of the files which you can provide. So unlike this, I can think about so much protection which my operating system through which it's through operating system this sort of protection can be provided. Now another component which has come up very fast in case of operating system is the networking. Because initially we used to talk about our systems either single user or multi-user. These are the usual system which we talk about. But networking has become an essential component of the systems these days. You can't imagine a system which is not networked, either through your own LAN or through the internet. Now, maybe then in that particular scenario, what happens is I may be working in a heterogeneous sort of environment. One of my system is, let's say, it's a 68,000 based, series based, another is Sun based, third is a Pentium based, fourth is a Solaris. Other is some other system hardware. It is based on that. Now, let's say I have to work, I have to talk, I have to message to all these sort of a systems. So, what we have to think of is some sort of a mechanism through which we can just network this sort of a things. Okay, whatever is a network, my operating system should be such that it should be providing me some sort of a support through which I can just link. Make use of the resources which are available to me in the network. What sort of resources are there? Let's say a printer is there. Printer is not available to me, but is available on some of the other site. My operating system should be able to give me some sort of facilities through which I should be able to print my file from my system to the other system. Maybe with the additional thing, okay, I must get this sort of permissions from somebody else to make before making use of the resources, because that sort of protocol has to be worked out. Okay, I must seek permission before making use of his resources there. Then another is a command interpreter. Maybe every system, every user system has got some sort of a mechanism through which he passes the command through the system. Maybe I may be using the keyboard to pass my commands, or I may be using some of the other media through which I will be passing my commands. It can be just typing out your commands. Operating system should be able to understand those commands and interpret and provide you the solution for that sort of a command there. Or it is a graphical user interface. What happens is every system which is being made use of us, that has got a graphical user interface, and through mouse interface, I will be making use of those sort of a commands. So basic idea is there should be some component of the operating system which is giving me this sort of a facility that my whatever commands I am giving, my system should be able to understand those sort of a commands. It can be just my visual commands can be there. Let's say I have got a biometric system on my system there through which I would like to interface. So some sort of a interfacing has to be provided to that sort of a device also. Or I am giving through keyboard, or I am giving through graphical user interfaces. So all sort of interfaces which can arise for giving the command should be able to be taken care by the operating system. Now, strength of the operating system depends upon that. As you might have encountered, if I look at DOS, initial operating system which used to be there, they used to be very small in size. Why they were used to in size? Because there is not very many complexities there. I'm a single user who is working on the system. There is no network there. And there is not very many interfaces there. So I'm very comfortable by having a very small operating system which comes on a small floppy also. Now you think about the other type of operating system. Maybe Unix is another type of operating system. There's other name which is there. Maybe the complexity of the operating system has increased. Process management, since there can be number of processes which can be there, my complexity has increased. That has increased the complexity of my operating system. That is, the way complexity of your hardware increases, the complexity of your software will also increase accordingly. If I'm having a single user system, complexity of operating system will be too low. The moment I go for the network system, the complexity of the operating system will be increased further. And once complexity increases, the size of the operating system keeps on increasing. So this is one of the reasons why there are operating systems which are very smaller in size, and there are operating systems which are very large in the size there. Maybe we'll talk about all these components of operating system to some extent. And mind it, most of the operating system has to be managed in this particular components only. So basically, we are managing these components only once we are talking about the management of a operating system there. Now, first, as I said, it is the process management which is the component. Now, what is the process? It is any program which is in execution. Once a program is in execution, we say it's a process. Once a program is not in execution, we say it's a program. There's a basic difference between process and the program there. Now, what are the major functions which are being done by this process management is, it's basically resource allocator, it manages the execution, and it synchronizes and deadlock handling. So these are some of the major components which are there, which are handled at the level of the process management there. Now once we say resource allocator, now every system has got number of resources there. Maybe CPU is one of the resource, maybe IOs is the one or another type of resource, memory is the another type of resource. So it is basically allocating that sort of a resources at the time my process requires those sort of resources. Once my work for that particular resource is over, it takes back that sort of a resource there. Basically, we say it's a allocation of the resource or the deallocation of the resource there. Then it has to manage the execution. Manage the execution is the moment my process has to be loaded into the system and executed from some of the instructions there. So this is what is being done by the process management only. Then another major component where lot of complexities comes to your operating system is the synchronization. Let's say there are two processes which are there. Maybe I can explain you better on the board. Let's say there are two processes which are there, process A and process B which is there. Now what is process A doing is, let's say there is some sort of instructions which are there, and then these processes process A and process B that has got some of the common variable. You can assume there is some sort of a common variable which are there. Let's say both the processes are executing. Let's say there is some common variable x. It says x is equal to 2. And in the next instruction, it says, let's say x is equal to x plus 2. And then in the next instruction, it says print x. Maybe we are using some pseudo language over here. Now, over here, it says x is equal to 3. And it says x is equal to x minus 1. And it says print x. Let's say there are two processes, maybe some processes are there. Maybe child process or some other processes are there. Now, let's say this is some sort of instruction which are there. Now, what happens? How should I execute this sort of instruction there? One is, let's say, this process A execute this instruction, then this instruction, then this instruction. Or, what happens is, okay, let's say it starts from here, goes to the this particular instruction, then it goes to this particular instruction, then it goes to this particular instruction, then it goes to this instruction, and then it comes to this instruction. Let's say it executes like this. What will happen? The moment I execute it like this, it will give you, let's say it gives you the result, x is equal to 2, x is equal to x plus 2, and print x, it will print 4. The value of x which will be printed in this case will be 4. Whereas the moment it executes like this, let's say it says x is equal to 2, it goes to the next instruction, x is equal to 3. Now the value of x becomes 3. And then it says x is equal to x plus 2, 5. And it becomes 4. And it maybe it is printing 4 only. But in some of the other instances, let's say it says x minus 2. Then the value which will be printed in this case will be 3 here. So, idea is not this instruction which is important. Idea is how these instructions are getting executed over there. So, this is the problem of the synchronization which comes up over here. Okay, the moment there is some sort of a shared variables, that's why maybe we'll cover up in details about all these things. Okay, the moment there is some sort of a sharing of the variable between two processes, we have to synchronize that sort of a execution there. Right? So, this is what we call as the problem of the synchronization. The next is the deadlock handling. Let's say, in case there are two processes which are there, then both are waiting for some resource. Because obviously, all the resources are not allocated to a process at the same time. Let's say it is waiting for some resources which is being held by the other process. Whereas there is another process B which is again holding the resource which is being waited by the process A. And then it is also waiting for the, it is waiting for the other resource there. The process A is holding a resource, process B is holding a resource. Both are waiting for the resource which are being held by the other. So what will happen? Nobody will be able to execute it. Maybe I can explain you in a simpler fashion. Let's say there is a process A. And there is process B. What has happened is, now let's say process A has got printer with it. And this, let's say I say this is allocated. And this is, it is waiting for a tape drive. And it, process B has got tape with it. And it is waiting for the printer. So, this is a condition of a deadlock. That is, what is happening is, I am holding this particular printer. and waiting for this particular tape, which is being held by the process B. Neither he is ready to leave this resource, nor he is ready to leave the resource there. So this sort of situation, we call them as a deadlock situations. Maybe still further, you can assume, okay, let's say there is some sort of a road. And in this direction, let's say there is a car, car one coming. From this direction also there is a car two coming. Now, this road is so small, okay, only one car can pass at a particular time. So, what will happen? This is again a situation of a deadlock there. So what is the resource in this particular case? Road. This road itself is a resource in this particular scenario over there. So this is what we call as a deadlocks. My system can get into a deadlock where two processes are waiting for the other to leave the resource. So this is what we call as a process management. Maybe there are algorithms which we'll talk at a later stage, okay, for the synchronization purposes, and there are algorithms through which we have to handle this sort of a deadlock situation. Maybe first is I have to find out whether a deadlock has occurred. And once a deadlock has occurred, I have to find out how exactly I can take care of that sort of a deadlock situation. So this all comes under this process management. Now next management which is required is the memory management. Now again, if I look at the memory, is the linear array which is there. And what we have to do is, we have to go for this sort of a allocation of a memory. That is the first thing which we have to do. Since every process requires some sort of a memory there, what we have to do is, we have to think about a mechanism through which I can allocate this sort of a memory there. Then now once the process is over, then we have to deallocate that memory and put it into the free block. Okay, wherever I am collecting my free memory, I will putting this memory at this particular deallocation stage there. Or I will be loading process into the memory for the execution. What do we mean by that? Loading process into memory for execution is, okay, I will be taking the process and put it into the main memory for the execution purposes. Or I will be taking the process or a program from the primary or secondary memory to the main memory there. So these are some of the memory management which we have to perform. Now what sort of management is required in this particular scenario also? Let's say what we have got is, this is what we call as our memory. Let's say this is my memory which is there. Now let's say this is the part which is taken care by the operating system. Now what we have to do is, whatever is the user memory which is there, I have to manage this. Let's say somebody comes, there may be some addresses for this memory. Maybe starting from zeroth location to some sort of a address is there. Now what we have to do is, let's say I say, okay, from this particular type, from this memory to this memory, from this location to this location, memory has been allocated to the process A. So this is what my operating system has to take care. Okay, starting from this particular address, let's say this is address is X, up to X plus, let's say 200, because let's say it requires 200 bytes or a word of the memory. So this is what we require. Okay, this much amount of a memory I have to allocate to this particular process there. So this particular thing we call as the allocation. And the moment this execution of this process A is complete, I have to take back this particular memory and put it back into the free space. So this is what we call as a memory allocation. Okay, I'm allocating, I'm
डीएलोकेटिंग.
So these are the two major steps which are there, which is concerned with the memory management. And then another is we have to provide some sort of protection. Let's say the moment, let's say there is another process which is there. Let's say there is a process B which is there. What happens is, ki I must take care that once my process is executing, this sort of a boundaries are be taken care. My process doesn't cross the boundary and goes to this particular area, or it goes to this particular area, or it goes to this particular area. This is what has to be taken care once we talk about this sort of a memory management. Now, another type of a management which is there is, we call it as a file management. That is, whatever are the files which are there, that has to be creation of that particular file. That is one operation which we have to perform. Or there is a deletion of the files. Okay, once a file has been created, I have to delete it. Or another type of a files which is there is a directories. Maybe this is another type of a file which is there, but it has got a different characteristics. Okay, my directory will be having all sort of a information about the files only. It may not be having any additional information there, no other text, but it just contains the information about the files only. Basically, it is the creation of the files, deletion of the files, or creation of directories, or deletion of the directory. These are the major components which is being handled by this file management. And then we have to perform some sort of a manipulation of the files or the directories. By manipulation, we mean, obviously, manipulation is taken as a very negative term. But in case of a computer, we say it's a manipulation of the files or the directories. Okay, we have to read something from the file. We have to write into the file. We have to zap some of the information which is there in the file. So this is all what is there in a file management. Let's say, once we say file management, how does the system perform this? So this system, every system performs this sort of task with the help of system calls. There may be some system call which allows me to open a file. Then there may be another system call which may be allowing me to close this particular file, or there may be some system call through which I can move the pointer from one place to the other, or there may be some other system call through which I will be rewinding that particular file. So all this are nothing but the some of the system calls which are there once we say it is a files management which we have to perform there. So all this, they fall under this file management. Maybe there are certain algorithms for these also through which all these sort of things can be done. Maybe that will cover up in our future lectures. Now then next we have got is IO management. As we were discussing earlier, okay, every device has got its own characteristics. Okay, once a device has got its own characteristics, I must be having some sort of a mechanism through which I will be accessing this particular device. My device can be slower in getting the data, slower in processing the data, or it can be very fast in accessing the data, very fast in processing the data. Let's say my printer is there. My CPU as such is generating data at a very faster pace, whereas my printer is not able to accept the data in that particular pace there. So what will happen? In case I allow them to communicate that in that particular fashion only, maybe some of the data will be lost in between. So what we do is, yes, how we do this sort of problem? We try to find, have some sort of a buffers in between. That is what happens is, okay, my system is there. It is not straight away sending the data to the printer. There is some buffers which are there in which my data goes there, and from the buffers it again gets printouts there. So this is the usual mechanism through which we just go for this sort of a task. Okay, that's what we call as a management of the external devices. By management, as I said, okay, how these devices can be made use of. Just like I got tape as another device. Again, tape is a sequential device. So if I wanted to read that particular device in a dynamic fashion, in a random fashion, I can't do it. What I had to do is, I had to do it only sequential fashion. That is the characteristics of this particular device. So what I had to do in case I have to copy, maybe I have to copy all the data on the hard disk. From there, I can read some of this particular information there. So basically, in case of I/O management, we are to manage input and output operation from and to the I/O devices. Maybe I am reading or writing on the device, or I am extracting the information from some of the device there. Maybe input, it can be input device, I will be reading from that particular device. In case it's an output device, I will be writing into that particular device there. My operating system, the uses of this I/O management is, it helps me in reading or writing onto that particular device there. So, now you imagine, every device has got its own characteristics. The way it has to be written, the way it has to be read, everything is different. So, if you leave this thing to the user, what is the fate of the user? So, that is why this sort of intricacies which are related to the devices are being taken care of by my operating system. Whereas, user, he simply says, okay, I would like to read, I would like to write. I never think of, okay, at this particular place I have to write, at this particular speed I have to write. I don't bother about that. But my concern is, okay, I will be reading or writing on this particular device in this particular fashion there. As you see, okay, in case of a language, I may be having a read or a write as two commands only, whether it is writing on a hard disk, whether writing on a tape, or whether it is writing on some other device there. Maybe in case of some of the languages, if I had to write on the printer, there may be some logical device number to this. If I had to write on the tape, there may be some logical device number which is available to that particular device there. So, all these aspects are being handled with the help of the operating system there. Now, these are the major managements which are there. Now, there are other types of management which my operating system has to perform. Maybe it has to, one of the same things which we say is, basically we have got a protection system there. By protection system, we mean okay, it has to protect your resources or protect your files or protect your data which is available on your system there. Now, once we are to protect, it may be quite possible okay, I may be creating some sort of a logins onto my system. Because basically, it's a logins which also gives you protection from the other users there. Or you can imagine, let's say you don't provide any protection in between. You are giving printing. Let's say there are three users, user A, B, C. They give the print command on the same printer. What will happen? Let's say I don't provide any sort of a mechanism. Maybe output will be there. It will be stacked. One line from one user, another line from the other user there. Or protection in the sense that I have created a file. Another user comes and makes some sort of a modification in that particular file there. What will happen to that particular file? Maybe my data will be deleted. Maybe data will be updated without my knowledge there. So this is what we have to think of, some sort of protection which we have to provide. Or as a user, I would like to give the protections. Let's say I'm the creator of a file. I'm the owner of a file. I would not like anyone else to modify this particular file. Or I would like to think about the other type of a users whom I will allow only for the execution of that particular file. Maybe as a user, I should be able to define this sort of a protection as far as my file is concerned. I should be able to protect my files from other sort of unauthorized user. That's one thing. Another is the way rights I would like to give to the other users there. And another is your networking. Since networking is also becoming an integral part of the system, so what we have to have is some sort of a protocols has to be implemented in your operating system there. Maybe the way I would like to give rights for my resource uses or sharing of the resources. Maybe there are number of users there. I don't have got a resource. I would like to share it with some other user there. Or I don't have got a space on my hard disk. I would like me storing my data on some other hard disk. Or I would like to have an application which is in a distributed fashion. It's a client-server application whereby data may be available to me locally. Data may be available to me at other sites there. So I should be able to process this sort of data. Now this is the operating system which helps me in this sort of environment there. In case of a networking, this becomes still more complex because I will be dealing with a heterogeneous sort of systems and I will be dealing with a heterogeneous type of the operating system which is available on this sort of environment. How exactly they can coordinate and work. So this is what we have to see as far as the networking is concerned. Then we got a command interpreter. Some sort of interpretation we have to have for the command there. As I said, this is one other type of management which has to be there. Whatever command the user gives, how exactly that sort of a command can be understood by the other users there. Or there can be some sort of exception handling. Suddenly your process was in execution. You usually say my system has hanged. That is one sort of exception which is there. Let's say I'm trying to write it on the floppy. Floppy drive is not responding. I think you might have seen the earlier systems where you keep on setting, okay, system, this particular system is not responding. You keep on waiting. Ultimately, what you do is you boot up the system again. But now the systems are there whereby some sort of exceptions, like if I am using a resource which is not responding, then my operating system has to monitor. Okay, the moment this sort of a resource which is not responding, which is faulty, my system should come back to me by informing that this particular resource is not available or this resource is not responding at that particular moment there. So this is some of the exception handling which we say. So maybe in nutshell, what we can say is, as far as our first topic is concerned, where we said, what are the various components of operating system, based on the type of the uses of the system which we have got, we have tried to find out, okay, this is the uses, this is the way my operating system can be compartmentalized, it can be process, because my process has to execute. Process management is there. It has to be allocated memory. Memory management is there. It has to have some IOs. So IO management is there. Hard disk is to be managed. We have got a scan resource management there. Or some sort of a commands has to be interpreted. I have got a command interpreter there. So like this, we have got all sort of a components. Now, basic idea is we would like to provide some sort of facilities to the users, so that he does not get into the intricacies of the hardware which is available to me at the back level only. Now then we try to classify the operating system also. Now it can be classified based on the type of the operating system which can be there or the type of the computer system it can be there. It can be as far as my operating system is concerned, it can be batch system or it can be time sharing or it can be real time systems. I may be having batch processing, that is used to be very earlier concept which used to be there. What used to be done is, let's say if I had got 10 Fortran jobs or 10 Pascal jobs, what I'll do is I club all these jobs together, execute at the same time only. I make a batch of those jobs, load the operating system, or load the particular compiler only once, and compile all the 10 jobs over there. This used to be our earlier concept of the batch system. Okay, I would not like to waste time in terms of loading the compiler, then again changing the compiler. You know, that used to be earlier concept where we will go to offline processing also. Now, then next type of system which has come up is the time sharing. What is being done is, in case there are number of processes there, let's say there is process A, B, C, D, E. Now what we do is, in case there are number of processes there, what I do is, instead of giving them time at the same time for the execution, I give them a time slice. Okay, take this particular time slice, execute your statements in that particular time slice. The moment that time slice is over, we stop that execution, suspend this execution, go to the other process for the execution. Maybe this sort of a thing works in a round robin. Okay, process A is giving time, process B is being given time, then process C is being given time. So like this, each of the processes are being given time for the execution purposes. Or next is the real-time processing. What we do is, my time constraints are so critical that within this particular time, this particular task has to be completed. I say it's a real-time. Of course, once we say real-time, it has to be online also. Now, then another division which we have got about the operating system is based on the system which we have got. I may be having a multi-programming system, I may be having a multi-processing, or I have got a network of computing system, or I got a distributed computer system. My systems are such that in that particular memory only, I can load number of processes there. That becomes a multi-programming. Or instead of a one processor there, there are number of processors there. Or it is on a network mode. It is not a single process system which is there as a system. But there are number of heterogeneous systems which are there. And they have been clubbed together. Or they are the distributed operating systems. So each of them gives rise to some sort of a complexity into your operating system. Now in case I got a system where only one process can be loaded, all the memory I'll allocate to the same process. Or in case there is a processor which we have got as a multi-user, multi-programming. Let's say what happens is, this is my OS which is there, and I have got this sort of processes which are there, through which I can load this sort of information there. So now then this particular aspect becomes a multi-programming, because I am able to load number of programs into the memory. So this is how do we classify this. Maybe what happens is, let's say this is my CPU. Now process P1 goes over there. The moment it completes, it will be swapped out, and another process, P2, will be loaded into your CPU. So like this, the processes keeps on coming and going into their CPU there. So this is what we call as a multi-programming systems. Now another is a multi-processing systems. Usually people have got some sort of a confusion about this sort of a systems only. Now in case of a multi processing, what we have got is, we have got a number of, let's say, CPUs. Let's say CPU 1, CPU 2, and CPU. There is a system is there, where there are number of CPUs which are there, and there are number of processes which are there in the memory. Now, what happens in this particular scenario is, P1 goes to CPU 1, P2 goes to CPU 2, and P3 goes to the CPU 3 over there. So this is what we call as a multiprocessing. Okay, there is more than one processor there, and each processor can execute one job at a particular time there. And network, as I said, network is some sort of a system where we have got a client-server computing, or heterogeneity of environment is there. I may be having a number of systems which has got its local power of the system also, as well as the power of the other systems there. So based on this particular power, it keeps on executing some of the jobs there. Or it can be distributed system there, whereby what we have got is, we have got a very tightly coupled system and a loosely coupled software there, and they just interact. So maybe your client server computing and other things, they fall under this particular distributed systems there. So like this, we can classify them based on the hardware which is available to us and the based on the way the operating system which is available to you. One can be operating system feature, other can be the computer system feature. Based on this, I can classify whether it's a multi-program, whether it's a multi-processing network or the distributed system there. So in nutshell, what we can say is, once we say about the classifications, it can be your batch processing, it can be your time sharing, or it can be real-time system. And once we say it's based on the hardware, we say it's a multi-programming, multi-processing, or network, or a distributed system. Another thing you can observe is, they cannot exist in isolation. There is another aspect which is very important about operating systems. Okay, these sort of operating system, they cannot exist in isolation. I can't think of a system which is just a time sharing, but not a multi-programming. I can't imagine this sort of a system, or a multi-processing system, but which is not with the multi-programming. I got a multi-processing system, but not multi-programming. I can't imagine this sort of a scenarios. So that's a head. that's what we say. Okay, once any systems is there, leave us out single user system, other type of a system, they exist, they coexist. If my system is time sharing, maybe it is multi-programming, maybe it is a multi-processing also. Or I got a network system, maybe it can give you the flavor of the multi-users also, or it gives you the flavor of a multi-processing also. So like this, they just combine together to give you this sort of a environment where you can work in different type of a environment, in different type of a classification there. Maybe we stop here. Thank you very much.